Welcome to the Woglakapi show, brought to you by KOLC-TV of Oglala, Lakota College. Today we have two special guests, and I'd like to have them introduce themselves at this time.
Hello, my name is Mary Isaacson, and I am an assistant professor from South Dakota State University College of Nursing, and I teach in the Sioux Falls campus, but am actually affiliated with all the campuses, which are in Brookings, Sioux Falls, and Rapid City and Aberdeen. And I've had the pleasure to work with my colleague here on the side, who I will let her introduce herself.
Patricia catches the enemy in my job. Lakota, elders,
Okay. Thank you very much, and good morning. Welcome to you to the KOLC-TV. Can you tell us at this time some of the history of this program?
I'll start that. Approximately in 2012, while I was teaching at Augustana University with some nursing students, we met with a palliative care physician, and I'll talk more about what this word palliative care means, from Avera McKinnon Hospital. And a question that she posed to us is, why do we see so many Native Americans here on the eastern side of the state seeking palliative care? And as we considered that, we had no idea. And so we interviewed healthcare professionals that were Native American, and then we also interviewed palliative care healthcare professionals to find out why is that? And truly, it's about misperceptions and misconceptions as to what the term palliative care means, but it's also a fear or an uncertainty on the part of us as white healthcare providers, wanting to make sure that is palliative care culturally appropriate and culturally congruent with the Lakota way of life, and does it fit, and not for us to bring a program of care that maybe isn't appropriate. So that led me to seeking grant funding that I received from South Dakota State University, and it was a small seed grant of roughly $2,500, where I met with the Oglala Sioux Health Administration and asked, is there a way that we could get together? Or first of all, is there an interest in this concept of palliative care? And palliative care is about symptom management, and it's for individuals, any individual that has been diagnosed with a chronic illness. And when you think about a chronic illness, probably one of the first things that comes to mind is cancer. And cancer and palliative care go hand in hand. But it also is diabetes. It is those with chronic renal failure. And palliative care looks at the person holistically, because we understand that an individual has suffering that is not only physical, but it's emotional, it's social, and it's spiritual. And how is this something? Number one, we know that the American Indian population in South Dakota has a high chronic illness rate, but yet palliative care isn't available. And is this something, is it because of a lack of interest, or is it because of not an understanding on both parties? And they were very interested, and we felt that in order to understand, is this something that would work well with this population, that we needed to meet with elders and get their opinions. So in the spring of 2014, we actually met and started focus groups over in Pine Ridge. And the first question and the first meeting was actually with probably about six or seven elders from the Pine Ridge area that had been gathered from the at that time healthcare administrator. And it was to discuss what is palliative care. And I gave that definition about what is palliative care to the individuals, but then there's another term that comes with palliative care, and that's called hospice care. And hospice care has those same principles. It's all about caring for somebody holistically, physically, emotionally, spiritually, and socially. But it's also occurs at end of life, when somebody's life expectancy is within 6 months or so, and it's how do we provide that care to individuals? And so how do we talk about these things, and does this actually make sense and, again, fit in with the Lakota life ways? And so, Patricia, would you like to step in on this one?
Yes, actually, to back up on Mary's comment, was there were a number, quite a few number of elders that got together, and there were some from Porcupine and Manderson, and I believe, was it Allen or
yes.
someplace? Anyway, there were a number of us that we didn't really understand what palliative care was or is. And then through contact with Marion, and we found out that there was no palliative care west of the river. You know, so that got us more, you know, heads up on, you know, even regional. No wonder some of our elders were being shipped to Sioux Falls, Denver, Billings, you know, Montana, you know, because of the lack of resources. And, you know, I don't think Lakota people or Native people are any different from non-Natives. We all have health issues, you know, especially at our age when we're nearing or at our with elders, we're in our fourth cycle of life. We should be concerned about who's gonna take care of me when I'm not able to take care of myself. You know, who's going to when I have a heart attack or a stroke, who's gonna make those decisions for me? You know, what is it I want, or who do I want to carry on? You know, maybe I'd have little property or little land or, you know, something. Those decisions need to be addressed.
Yeah. You know, in my family, I've had three deaths in our family, and it's always came up to me that I was always the one that was going to be the decision maker. Okay, can you get more in depth of who should be a decision maker?
Well, traditionally, Lakota people sort of honored or favored the eldest child. You know, as we look back in our history, that's always been the protocol. But in this day and age, you know, it has to be somebody who's sound-minded, who's a little educated, who cares for the whole family, not just for self. And the reason why I say that is because we see so many. I used to work at the courthouse, and we see so many families at somebody's deceased family. They end up right away in a courthouse, and there's a big conflict, you know. And I understand the probate takes care of that a year later or so, again, much later. But upon the death of the person, there's immediate conflict, and that's really sad. It shouldn't happen. You know, so as elders, we need to be more conscious of, and we know who they are. You know, we look at our children, our grandchildren, and our great grandchildren, and see who in our family that is, you know, sober, is realistic. You know, and who's gonna speak for me in case I'm not able to speak for myself?
To jump back a little bit, we spoke of palliative care and hospice care Can you tell us the differences between those two aspects?
Certainly. As I mentioned, palliative care is about caring, viewing the individual in a very holistic fashion. So if, and it's best when it's implemented at the time of a chronic illness. So say, for example, if an individual has been diagnosed with cancer, what should happen, you know, whether they're going to have radiation therapy or chemotherapy, surgery, is that not only do they have that specialized cancer team, but then you also initiate what's called palliative care, where these individuals really kind of coordinate everything so that they know that the communication between all parties is occurring, and what's most important is that the patient and the family are at the center of this care. They are in charge of their care, and they're asking, how does this fit for you? Does this make sense for you? How are you feeling? How are your emotions? How is your spirit? How are you, you know, besides pain, physical pain, how are you inside? And understanding that, you know, if you're diagnosed, that maybe you have to travel great distances in order to receive that treatment, then trying to make sure that those connections are there so that that care can continue and making sure that the family's cared for. So that's truly about palliative care. And then maybe once the person has received the treatments, is considered then cancer-free, then palliative care can actually drop out because it's not needed at this point. But then, for example, say that somebody does have a cancer diagnosis and they've undergone the treatments and have done well, and then all at once the cancer returns, and they find that they can't have any more treatment, and that the doctor says, you know, there truly is, we need to keep you comfortable. It's considered supportive care. And that is what we call hospice care. And by that, then normally they're saying, you know, the life expectancy is much less, and the prognosis is much less. And so that's when hospice care would be initiated. And I was a hospice nurse for a number of years in the Vermilion, South Dakota area, in a rural area. And hospice care can occur in an inpatient setting, meaning in a hospital. It can occur in a nursing home. And it can also occur in a patient's home. It's wherever that person and that family, and as long as safety is met, that care can occur. And what's really important with palliative care and hospice care is, again, that patient and family are in charge of every decision that they make. And so you make sure that you're managing pain very well. And if a person chooses to have their last and final days in the home, and we can do that, then that's what we do. And also bringing in volunteers and supportive care. Hospice care is currently reimbursed by Medicare and many major insurance companies and also Medicaid. And it has to be ordered. Palliative care has to be billed in a different way. Indian Health Service, especially in our area, does not offer palliative care and hospice care at this point. And so have we had conversations with the Pine Ridge Service Unit? Yes, we have regarding it. They're interested at this point. But again, I think funding is always a great concern as to how do you pay for that, and then also bringing training, et cetera, for individuals.
Okay, so jumping back to Patricia, she said we were talking about the decision maker. Mm-hmm. So it sounded like you were talking about an individual, but it could be the family as a group also?
Yes. Mm-hmm. Yes. I would recommend that as a family because, you know, that individual who is sick or near death needs a lot of support. And it's sad that, you know, that maybe he or she is incapable of making a decision for herself or himself, you know. And it's just at that point that somebody should step up, and especially if they're maybe brain dead by the physician, you know, who's gonna make that decision to pull the plug? you know, who's going to carry on the individual's wishes, last wishes, you know, and that all falls under the laws of respect and moral obligation, you know.
Okay. It I see this over and over where the person becomes an elder and becomes too old where he or she cannot make the decision. And the conversation has to come out at some point.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And I think all of us humans, we don't like the end, but it's going to happen. So how can we facilitate or get that conversation started? What should we do?
Yeah, well, we've gone to all the districts, all 9 districts, and we talked to our elders in Lakota and in book languages, and we encouraged them. It's surprisingly to me, when we visited all the elders, you know, when we went to their elderly meals at that time, so we caught a lot of elders, you know, and we asked them if they did their will, you know, or have they even considered it. And it was surprising to me that most of them did. Most of them have written their wills, you know, as far as stepping that forward into the end of life decisions, you know, the health care. That would be the next step that will should be included in the will or separate from the will, you know, however. And legal aid is one of our partners, and it's free. BIA used to do the living wills, but now legal aid will do that.
Can you define a will in the living will?
Well, so what kind of take, we've jumped kind of around in here. You know, that first project that I talked about was really defining palliative care and hospice care, and then applying the principles or what's needed if we were to design a palliative or hospice care program here on the reservation, what would that look like? So within that first project, that is what I and the elders did, is they mapped out, these are the principles, the Lakota principles, that need to go into that program to make sure that it fits with our way of life. But also what came from that program was that overwhelming need to have exactly what we're having here, that conversation about the living will, or another term that is used for this is called an advanced directive, is another term that people may hear. And by law, when a person comes into a healthcare facility, we're supposed to ask, do you have a living will or an advanced directive? And if a person says yes, then the person at the healthcare facility would say, may we have a copy of it, or do we have a copy of it on record? And you can say yes or no, and they can ask for the copy, but usually that's where the conversation stops. And if a person says no, they may give you some information on it. But do we ever do anything more with that? But back to this advanced directive piece, a living will is where the person, such as myself or such as Patricia, would say, if I'm unable to make my own decisions about my health care, if I can no longer speak or I'm too weak, then I designate, this is what I want done. You know, if I can no longer eat, then I don't want you to put a tube into my tummy or down my nose into my stomach. I just want nature to take its course. And you kind of lay out that, but you also typically in that designate that family person or persons to make those decisions. But what's important is that you also need to tell those individuals, I have made you in charge and these are my wishes. wishes. This is what I want to happen. Where a regular will is about the property, about your land, etc., and how you want that divided and dispersed, where a living will is all about health care and what you want done at that time. And you had mentioned it's a hard conversation. How do we start it? And for me, I think it's because of my years in hospice work. And my own mother was 87 when she passed. And I am the fourth of five children. So I wasn't the oldest, but I was her healthcare decision maker. My older sister was what they call that power of attorney. She was the one in charge of mom's finances, but I was in charge of her healthcare decisions. And my mother and I were very much the same in personality. And I'm kind of hard charging and very excited about life. And when you could see that as she aged, that things weren't, she wasn't moving as fast, etc. There was one afternoon I was just with her alone and sat beside mom and I said, "Mom, you know, I really want to make sure that when your time comes that I know what it is you want us to do." And I said, "Because that's really, really important to me. And do you know what it is that you want?" And she said, "Yes." And I said, "Can you tell me what that is?" And she said, "When it's my time, God's going to take me, and I want him to." So I knew. And then I asked those other questions. So, you know, if you can't eat, what do you want to do? And then we talked about it. And then I shared that with my brothers and sisters. Now, was that conversation easy for me? No. Did I cry during that conversation? Yes. But at the end of it, you knew that we would be able to honor everything that she wanted. And my sister and I also then planned her funeral with her. She told us exactly, "I want these songs sung. I want this kind of flowers. I don't want this, and I don't want this." So when her time came, everything was set up, and when we could grieve and be together as a family, not worrying about those small things. So does that help?
Yes, okay. Yes it does. But I guess I'll say that there is still chaos at times.
There is,
and,
yes.
And how do we help alleviate that? I mean, as you spoke, you were with your mother by yourself, and sometimes some of your siblings may not agree with you at that point, or they may say, "Well, who else heard her mom talk about that?" You know, and there may be somebody that is kind of undecided of what decisions should be made or thought that she talked to you about.
Right.
I don't know how else to
No, no, that makes this. And that is a common occurrence, especially in families where maybe the majority of the children have been around mom or dad or whoever is not doing so well. And so they've seen how, you know, the illness has decreased their energy supplies. And so they're pretty much on board. But it can often be that child that doesn't live nearby and hasn't been around for a while that comes in and says, "What are you doing? You know, how can you?" Or they're just not ready. So what I did in my circumstance is, well, number one, my mother actually did fill out what they call healthcare decision maker. The technical term is called a durable power of attorney for that. But she filled out a form and actually expressed her wishes. So it was in writing. And again, that form only goes into practice when that person cannot make their own decisions. So if they're able to talk and they're still of sound mind, they will always be in charge. And so if they choose that they don't want to do that anymore, they can change their mind at any time. So that's always an option that's out there. But I also brought my whole family together with mom in the room and said that mom and I had this conversation. And this is what mom has decided, and I raised each issue, and then mom, you know, about the not eating, not drinking, et cetera, and said, Mom, can you tell everybody what you have told me? So she was able to express what she wanted out loud to everybody. Again, that's kind of the ideal circumstances. So what do you do when somebody isn't quite ready?
Okay, in Lakota culture, Patricia, what issues have you seen or experienced that makes things more complicated, and how do you think we can resolve those issues?
Well, again, like Mary said, you know, it's really hard to do, because with all the alcohol and drug abuse that's probably within the majority of the families today, you know, it's not like it was 100 years ago. So today, again, it has to go back to, because of lack of communications, for one, you know, people usually don't talk to each other, or maybe there's already some conflicts that are ongoing, you know, so. But if the elder has been sick for a while, like with diabetes, or they're on dialysis, you know, we've dropped off some of these pamphlets at the dialysis too, so that they may give to their clients. And it's so important for the individual to make their wishes known and make their living, their wills and living wills, you know, because irregardless of whatever the family conflicts are, it still has to be done in this day and age, because you have land issues, and if we as elders don't do it, somebody else will, the government will, you know, and then you might end up in court, or, you know, and it compounds that conflict, you know, it doesn't resolve it. So it's really important for the elder to make their wills and their health issues, you know, especially if they're diabetic, if they're cancer survivors like I am. I'm both, you know, I'm diabetic plus I'm a cancer survivor. So I made my will, and I only have one daughter, so, you know, she knows what I want done, you know. And that's easy for me, but you see families that have really large large children and grandchildren. And who's taking care of grandma, you know?
Okay. In closing, would you like to say anything more?
So, Patricia, I guess I'd like to ask a question. So what recommendations would you give to individuals here? How would you start that conversation?
I guess, you know, we have a syndrome here. And it's so obvious that first of the month, grandma gets her check, you know, SSI or retirement or whatever, and everybody comes around then. I guess that would be an opportune time to gather your children or your grandchildren, whoever's living with you, to address that, you know. Or if you're able to, these pamphlets are distributed everywhere. We have more, but all the information is in these, you know, in these little pamphlets, and And I guess my recommendation would be to just call the lawyer or have one of your children take you to a lawyer or legal aid. It doesn't cost you anything. And start up the process of how you want, you know. And it's not superstitious. It's reality. We're dealing with real life issues here when we're elders. You know, it's just a natural process. You know, dying is part of life. And life is we go around that cycle of life. And we as elders should know that we're facing, you know, a natural process that we need to be ready for, you know. So talk to your minister or your, you know, social worker, mm-hmm. or somebody. Tell somebody to help you, you know, if your children can't take care of it for you. But you have to have it in writing. Because like I said, the government will take care of it if you don't.
And these and the living wills help, it again lets your wishes, allows you to be in charge and in control. And it also provides great ease and comfort, really, to the family, because that's what they want. Okay, I know now. I know what I need to do. And we need not to fear these conversations, but to actually welcome them. But again, not an easy conversation to initiate. And I guess we would also like to thank the South Dakota Comprehensive Cancer Control Plan. They provided us with grant funding in order for these elders to do this last step of the process, which were the development of the brochure and then also going out and doing the educational programs at the elderly meals. So,
also, our numbers are in here, too. Thank you.
Do you know the numbers offhand?
Yeah, Valeria's is 455-2381, and mine is 454-6762.
Right, and they've actually given just their own personal numbers to be in contact. But we have actually met with the social workers at, as you mentioned, the dialysis centers, mm-hmm. and at Indian Health Service. And they are using the brochures as well, and they can contact.
We have reached everybody, I think, across the OST.
Right. And we're headed to Rosebud April 20th, because they are also interested in seeing how did we start this so that they can potentially do something very similar.
Okay. Well, I'd like to thank you for coming. And this is a very important issue that all the elders, and actually, you don't have to be an elder, I don't think. You can do this at any time before you become an elder. Well, you still got sound mind. So I'd like to thank our guests coming today. And you've been watching the Woglakapi show from KOLC-TV. And this is Tony Brave saying, Duksha Ake.